the supermajority to require a two-thirds vote on future tax increases. Here from the League of Human Services is Mr. Danielle Smith. I always gotta apologize, I call her Dan, but she's official now.
Danielle now. Again, my name is Danielle Smith, I'm with the Michigan League of Human Services. I have a quick question for everyone. Can I just get a show of hands if you feel comfortable entrusting public services like your healthcare, Medicaid, public structures, roads, the votes about those public structures to about 13 senators in your state? No? No show of hands? Exactly. Just to repeat the question, I hear some people saying, what did she say? Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. If you would be willing to entrust a vote for public structures that you benefit from, like healthcare and access to safe roads and transportation, the retail, your local taxes remaining at something that's consistent with the economy, if you would entrust those decisions to only about 13 senators in your legislature, would you be willing to do that? I didn't think so. Nobody would be willing to do that. What Proposal 5 is proposing to do is take what along with the Michigan Constitution, is to strip that away and leave the vote up to about 13 senators in the state legislature. And of course, that same will be true for the state house. It would be two-thirds majority. They're calling it a majority, but it's actually a minority vote. And I really think it's ironic, with all due respect to Mr. Garcia and all due respect to Mr. Dobson, Matty Maroon has been really busy. He's also financing this, he's also financing Prop 5. And so it's actually through a group called Americans for Prosperity that we're strongly opposed to. So I'm just gonna spend a little bit of time explaining why we're voting no on Proposal 5, and what would happen if it was passed. So basically, it will require, again, a supermajority of two-thirds vote of both the State House and the Senate before any state tax could be enacted or raised. So in the history of our state legislature, no state tax or tax increase has ever passed the legislature with a supermajority vote. It's never happened. So basically, it would make it practically impossible, it would make it politically impossible to ever pass a state tax or major tax reform, regardless of whatever financial circumstance or emergency. And sometimes it's kind of a hard sell to say, well, you know, well, some people go, well, I don't want my taxes raised. But we also need to recognize what our taxes pay for and the public structures that we benefit from. So if it's passed, it's not gonna just affect one or two areas of government. So if it's passed, it will affect healthcare, it will affect our transportation, it will affect K-12 and higher education. It's definitely gonna affect our credit rating, our bond rating. So this proposal 5, if it's passed, instantly our credit rating is gonna be lower. There's 7 other states who have had the misfortune of having it passed in their state. Mississippi, Nevada, California, Oregon, Louisiana, and I forget the last 2 states, but of those states, all of them, as soon as this measure was passed, their credit rating was lower. They're at a disadvantage in their state. And the tax base within their state rolled over to their local government. So the slack was made up by the local municipalities. So the taxes went up locally and stayed static on a state basis. So when we look at Proposal 5, and the language is very convoluted, and my colleague Brunel Weathers has passed out some flyers that has the exact ballot language. It's very convoluted, and if you look at it at first glance, you might say, well, yeah, you know, that wouldn't be too bad, but this is so, if this is passed, this is so detrimental to everything that we look at as of value. If we look at Medicaid, for example, I have a little statistic here, if you just give me a moment, that talks about the effect that it would have on Medicaid. And I'm, you know what? Oh, okay. So it talks about blowing a major hole in the state's Medicaid budget. Now, Michigan's hospitals, they're required by law to treat every single patient that walks into the hospital room, correct? Mm-hmm. Now, the smaller hospitals, if someone comes into the hospital, obviously they're covered, and Medicaid takes up the slack. So right now, we have a pretty robust Medicaid budget to take care of people who are in vulnerable situations, seniors, children, low-income children and families. If this passes, that Medicaid, we no longer will have as much of a robust Medicaid plan, and smaller hospitals, they're not gonna be able to stay open. So when you look at the spiral, the trickle-down effect of that, the smaller hospitals that are no longer able to be open, that means the people that live in those communities have less access to healthcare. So that's just one example of one of the many ways we're opposing Proposal 5. I mean, I can't stress enough how detrimental this is to us. I have another example here that talks about local property taxes. In super minority states, and we're using this term at the league just to give you a better understanding of where we are, we're with a coalition called Defend Michigan Democracy. With Defend Michigan Democracy, we're looking at the two-thirds majority, and we tend to call it the super minority because that's what it is. But it says, state government fails to meet its obligations, and those obligations fall to local governments and schools. They're forced to increase local property taxes. Obviously, if they're forced to increase local property taxes, what does that spin off to? Inequity in education, inequity in the public services that we receive. So the last thing that we want to do is promote inequity on a local level or on a statewide level. So if this is passed, we won't have a tax base that remains static or the option to be able to increase taxes as needed or in an emergency. So I would really encourage everyone to vote no on Proposal 5, the super minority bill.
This brings up a lot of, I think NAACP should do a panel discussion or a debate on these issues and have both sides come and don't put that Kirby Center or here or wherever. So both sides can present their case to the people on all these proposals. That's number one. Number two, there are going to be state proposals
today. Coming up next to us is Ms. Sherry Gabe Donato, Regional Director for Center for Democracy on the PA coordinator, the Emergency Manager of Law. Please welcome Ms. Donato.
Thank you so much, Donnell. You look great. At the convention, I got a chance to spot you out there. Good afternoon now, everyone.
Yeah.
Thank you for this opportunity to come and share information about Proposal 1. I think you all have a rough draft, but it's the final copy of the question or ballot initiative. Proposal 1. I don't want to read to you. I am a teacher, but I don't want to read to you because I know that you can read this. But basically, I am working to recruit community team leaders, speakers, precinct delegates, as such, to have them gain a better understanding of the emergency manager law, PA4. As an educator, this law is impacting a number of facets of our community. It's impacting our schools because you know that our schools, many of our schools throughout the state of Michigan, predominantly in urban centers, have emergency managers. First, we had emergency financial managers, and you know the case that was adjudicated by Judge Wendy Baxter, which removed and transitioned us from PA 72 to PA 4. And the way that they word the question on the ballot seems to ask if we communities want someone to come in and to help balance our financial troubles, pretty much. So it's not really clear to some of our more distant Michiganians what we're facing in more urban centers. So it impacts school districts, it impacts collective bargaining. We know, for example, this, I call it a dictator law, but I know this is a bipartisan meeting. It takes away local control and people not having the right to make decisions for themselves. And as you can see from a number of the presentations prior to mine, that we have a governor that seems to think that that's the way to go, that the people should have a voice. And we are about the democratic process, regardless to which party you belong to, Democrat or Republican, people have a right to decide. That's the American way. And so for us to have a governor that seeks to circumvent that process and to cut off the vote and the voice of community, which this bill, from my perspective, seeks to do, as well as cut out the ability for collective bargaining, which impacts educators, our auto workers, our city workers, our city's assets. So just want to point out some examples of how it's impacted our education system thus far in the city of Detroit Public Schools. You know, we have a new state design school system, EAA, regardless of which side you are on this process or the implementation of this school district, we have an emergency manager within DPS that sits both on the board for DPS, or is on DPS as an emergency manager, but also sits on the board for EAA. I'm certain that you've heard all of the commercials and all of the marketing that has gone for EAA. You probably heard very little for DPS. And so we think that that's kind of commingling the funds, because there's also staff members that have demonstrated or gave testimony through school board that they too have worked for EAA. So if we have a deficit with DPS already, and our students are paying that deficit back approximately $1,100, I'm sure you know the numbers on that, but our children are being taken out of the system, and our books, our computers, our furniture remain in the EAA buildings, and then they're only paying $1 for the use of those buildings after we pay for them through Proposal S. That seems to be a dictator style of government. Actually, it's gangsterism. And so that's how it's impacting our schools. It's impacting our collective bargaining process for teachers, because they're forced to take a contract that demands 2-hour staff meetings, reduction of benefits, paying more for the health care. We all understand that we have to do more with less. But the way in which it's done, people who don't have any experience within the classroom or being administrators in the school building, really knowing what the needs are or engaging people as a part of that process, really speaks to the agenda of an emergency manager. So also with our city, we have an emergency manager. Well, they say he's not an emergency manager, but you determine what Jack Martin is for the city. Just recently I was at a rally for Ask Me, where it was pointed out that city jobs in the payroll department were going to be given to CompuWare. And so that process, until they were called out on it, many of our city jobs are in jeopardy. And so how do a community that has been supported by our school system, working and being in the trenches every day to teach our children, working for the city, how do our citizens continue to sustain themselves if public dollars are taken away from the taxpayers and now those monies or businesses are given to private industry? I just read a memo yesterday with the Detroit Water and Sewage Department, where a $17.1 million and $3 million combined contract is given to EMA Inc. I don't quite know who they are yet, but they are to come in and assess the fiscal stability of the Detroit Water and Sewage Department and give recommendations of how they could level the cost of operations. And that money is being paid in by the citizens. So that's what this bill and how it's impacting a number of areas throughout our community. And so in working with Stand Up for Democracy and organizing community, our goal is to educate community on how it's impacting our education system, how it's impacting our city services, how it's impacting our police, fire, auto workers, and just democracy as a whole. We are about defending democracy, and people should have a voice regardless to who they vote for. And so that's pretty much a summation. There are plenty of specialists. I'm not a PA Corps specialist. James Hunter back there is more of a PA Corps specialist on this issue, but just more as an education advocate, I know firsthand the experience of being moved around and shifted around and how it's actually dismantling public education. And so that's my plea to you, is to put a face, a real face, on how it's impacting each of us individually throughout the community.
Thank you, Michelle. Let's thank again, Michelle.